What's up, bitches? Today's vlog is story time! Yay! More specifically, stories about when I've gone to anime cons and it hasn't really gone as planned. Yes, I go to anime cons, shut up. I won't be telling my most interesting stories because I've already talked about them in like previous ways, like journals or just comics or something. So my most interesting stories happen to be about one time I caught Becca at a rave. Another time Becca and I got stuck in an elevator, which is what I talked about, I think, in my last vlog. And one time this guy came and hit on Becca when she was like 16 and he was 21, I think. But I'm not gonna talk about those because I've already explained them. So if you want to learn about the story, look it up, you lazy bastards. I'm just kidding, I love you. But anyway, let's begin. My first memorable moment from an anime con was one time, it was my second year at AWA, which is Anime Week in Atlanta, and it was around midnight on Friday, and I went down to the lobby, and there was this circle that was playing Duck Duck Goose. And I thought, hey, I can join, and we'll have fun, because, you know, it was midnight on Friday, and I was in cosplay, and I was kind of fucked up. But anyway, so we start playing Duck Duck Goose, which, by the way, was very hard for me, because I was dressed up as C2 from Kogiyaa Season 1, and if you don't know, my entire outfit was basically belted down. Like, I had a giant belt going around my chest, and I had like belts on my arms and my legs, and so I couldn't move. And I was also wearing 3-inch heels, so it was hard to run around. I definitely lost. But anyway, at one point I was Goose, and so the girl tapped me and she said Goose, and so I started running around the circle very slowly, by the way, because I was in 3-inch heels and I wasn't used to cosplay yet, so I was like, ow, 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 yeah. Anyway, as I'm halfway around the circle, my body suddenly is lifted up from the ground, and my feet can't even touch the floor. And all of a sudden, my body is starting to be swung from left to right without my control. My limbs are literally going like this because it's such a powerful force. And from behind me, I can hear someone yelling into my ear, I love you, C2! And I am such in shock because I am actually being picked up and thrown around like a ragdoll that my only response is, I love you too! And then he sets me down and runs off, and he was so fast that by the time I turned around, he was gone. I couldn't even see him anymore. And I turned towards Becca and I said, what the hell was that? And she said, dude, some giant dude just picked you up. And I was like, where is he? And she was like, he was right there. So that was my first memory. I realized how little weight I actually had. I think it was like 93 pounds at the time because I was like, I want to say I was like 13 at the time. Although I'm 17 now and I'm pretty sure he would still be able to do it. So yeah, that was memorable. So even though I sucked at Duck Duck Goose, I still got lifted up by some crazy huge dude. You guys are going to love this next story. This next story is actually about my most embarrassing moment ever. So you guys are going to love it. And the reason I can talk about this was because it wasn't all bad. So I think this happened 2 years ago when Becca and I went to AWA again, Anime Week in Atlanta, and we were in the dealer room, and Becca wanted to buy something. It was like a figure or something. But as she was looking through her bag, she says, Aaron, I don't have my wallet. I think I left it up in the room. And so I was like, okay, we'll go get it. So we leave the dealer room and we go back to the hotel, which, by the way, takes a lot of walking because the convention area is fucking huge. So we finally get up to, so we get in the elevator and we go up to our floor. And here's what happened. I brought Becca along with me and I made Becca have the responsibility of remembering our room because I thought that since she was the responsible one, she'd be able to because I guess didn't want to keep up with it because I'm lazy. So big mistake, by the way. What happens is, I think most hotels are like this. You get off the elevator and it's kind of like a circle. And what happened was, the first time we got off the elevator to go put our bags in our room, we went to the right of the elevator, which is like the left to you guys because the camera is reversed. But we went to the right of the elevator and we kind of went like 8/10 of the circle and there was our room. And so Becca did not memorize the room number like I thought she would. And she instead memorized where in the circle the room was. And so this time when we got off the elevator, we went left, which is right for you guys because the videos were first, but we went left. And again, she went 8/10 around the circle, but it was on the opposite end. And so we did not hit our room, but she kept saying, you know, this is our room. And I believed her because she was in charge of the room. And so she tried to stick her key in, and it did the little red beep thing, and so the card wasn't working, and so we're like, what? And so we kept trying to, like, open up the door, and Becca even stopped a custodian and was like, how the hell do we open the door? And eventually, I thought I could just, like, get my dad's attention, because my dad was inside, because he had to pay for the hotel room, because Becca was not old enough to reserve the hotel room at the time. Anyway, so I thought, if I could just get my dad to come to the door and open it, you know, we can get inside. And so what happened was I started banging on the door and screaming out the word daddy, because I thought I could get his attention that way. I just went, dad, 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 daddy, daddy! And after about 7 seconds of me doing this, the door opens, and there is a room filled with at least seven people at the minimum, who are easily in their, like, early to mid-20s, just staring at me. And the guy who opens the door is, like, this really big guy just, like, staring down at me, and he said, I'm not your daddy. And I freak. And I'm just like, oh my god. I just knocked on these people's doors, and just screamed daddy. And so I thought, in my scumbag mind, I thought maybe if I yelled at Becca, I could redeem myself and look like the mature one of us. So basically, I know this is gonna sound bad, but I started calling her a cunt. And I thought if I did that, like, they would realize it was Becca's mistake. And as I'm calling her, like, a cunt and saying, like, I thought you memorized the room number, this girl who's dressed as Eureka from Eureka 7 came up to the door, and she said, hey, did one of you lose a wallet? And then I was just like, whoa, shit just got real. We did. And she was like, yeah, it was, like, right outside your door. You must have dropped it. And we saw someone pick it up and take it down to the front desk. And we were just like, oh my god, because if you imagine if we went straight to our hotel room instead of knocking on their doors, we would have not found her wallet, and there would have been a major freak out. But because I knocked on their door and screamed daddy, we found her wallet, and that, I guess that's why I can talk about it, because it didn't end that badly. Anyway, the ending of the story is we go down to the lobby, and we go up to the front desk, and we get her wallet back, and as she's looking through her wallet, she finds these little notes. And remember, this is Becca's wallet, so she has, like, these weird little notes, like, behind her ID, there was a note that said, you have a pretty smile, and behind her library card was a note that says, I've checked out too many books with your library card, and where her money's supposed to be stashed, they had folded it. They had, like, folded and straightened her money, and so we were a little creeped out, but it was also nice because she checked, none of the money was stolen, you know, they said, you know, you have a nice smile, so that was good. So yeah, we got her wallet back, so happy ending to the embarrassing story. This next story is probably my most memorable story from an anime con ever. It was when I won a AMV award, AWA. By the way, I don't think I'm going to win another one because I kind of pissed off the staff. Basically, to get into the AMV awards, you had to have little stickers on your badge, and one said AMV creator, and which was me, and then he told me to have, like, a My Little Pony sticker on my badge, and he didn't give me a choice, and so I put it on, and then later on the forums I complained. I was like, you told me I had to have it on my badge, and they were like, no, you didn't. I said, well, can you not make it My Little Pony next year? Because, you know, it's kind of weird. Can you just give us neon stickers instead? And they were like, why do you not like My Little Pony? And they actually tracked down my DA page and, like, spammed it there. Like, they didn't just yell at me in the forums. They, like, found my DA page and just, like, said, you know, you should like My Little Pony. They literally put, like, essays on my comment section, like, really long comments just saying, like, you should like My Little Pony and you should enjoy your child inside. And, you know, you're acting really mature. And I was like, dude, I just wanted a neon sticker, okay? I didn't want a fucking pony on my badge. Anyway, so I got my badge and I went to the AMV Awards, and I won, though. I was in the expo contest, and I think there were, like, 10 videos that were shown or something, and I was one of them, and mine was called Best Fan Service, and I used the song Raise Your Glass. I put it with, like, a bunch of clips of cosplayers and anime together. It was a terribly made AMV. I feel really bad about it now, but at least it won. So I got in there, and this little black screen pops up, and, you know, it says, like, Best Fan Service, and I was like, oh, I bet this is gonna be, like, an AMV about boobies. All of a sudden, it, like, it it, all of a sudden it faded in. It was my video, and I kind of freaked. I did this exactly. I went, and I was such a fangirl. And it started playing, and they had increased the bass in my video, and so instead of just being like raise your glass, it was like, and so it was kind of like a party. And about halfway through the song, everyone started clapping. And by the way, there were about 500 people in the room, so I was spazzing. And at the very end of the video, I went up to get my award, and the guy asked me. He said, "Did you go to the rave last night?" And I said, "No." He said, "Well, we played your video at the rave, and we basically blew the roof off." And I was like, and then he took the mic and yelled at this crowd of 500 people, "How many of you were at the rave last night? We blew the roof off with this video." And, I was freaking out. And, by the way, there was a lot more emotion to it than that. I was just trying to simplify the story. But, so a few videos after mine, I think there were only like three videos after mine, and then the expo contest was done. We had missed some of the Oron Maid Cafe takeover because of it, and so after my video, I was like, alright, let's bounce. So we left, and as we left, I made the most graceful exit ever. I tripped over someone's bag, and I was in the front row, so it was noticed. But anyway, that is the simplified version of the best moment of my life. At AWA after midnight, all of the video rooms stop showing, like, all ages anime, and instead they start showing, like, hentai in every single one of the anime rooms. So one time, around 1 in the morning, Beck and I were chilling in the lobby, and we looked over and we saw one of the video rooms. And, by the way, we weren't thinking, we didn't remember that they only showed hentai after midnight. So we were like, I wonder what they're playing over there. So we walked over to the hentai room, and by the way, the door was cracked. And so we could easily see, and we didn't have to go in. And there wasn't anyone standing guard outside checking badges. And so we just walked over there, and we peeked in, and we saw this, like, guy yelling at other guys who were holding this girl. And as we're watching it, by the way, staff members saw us through the door, but they didn't make any move to, like, try to make us move, but we had, like, a pretty good view. And all of a sudden, the guys start, like, ripping off this woman's shirt, and her boobies start bouncing everywhere, and I was just like, oh, nope. Don't get me wrong, I love hentai as much as the next person, but I never understood the point of being in a room with a bunch of other people watching hentai. I mean, how would that work? You just stand up and all your erections are up. Just what? It'd be embarrassing for me, because if I wanted to watch hentai, I want to watch it alone. I don't want to, like, be next to, like, 50 other people. No. So that was very short, but we could have stayed there if we wanted. I mean, the staff didn't make us leave or anything, but I could not watch hentai in front of other people. I'm sorry. It's awkward to me. My last story was easily one of the most frightening, moments of my life, but it wasn't really that big of a deal. What happened was my brother was working staff at AWA. All these stories happen at AWA, but I swear to God, that's not the only convention in Georgia. But my brother was working staff at AWA, and at one point in the night, he was staffing outside of a rave. Like, it was an A&B party. It wasn't the big rave that happened, but it was like a really small rave where they have, like, rave A&Bs playing, and that's where they show my video. Like, not that year, but that's, like, the panel where they show my video. Anyway, so I see him, and I say, like, Edgar, what's up? How's it going? And we start talking, and then he's like, do you want to go on the rave? And we're like, no, we don't really want to go on the rave. He's like, go on the rave, it's fine. And so he pushes us into this dark room, where it's just going, mch. By the way, we're in our pajamas at this time because we had just come from, like, a pajama party, a cosplay pajama party, as one of the panels. And so we're, like, in our slippers and our little stuffed animals, like, you could feel the bass through the floor and the walls, and, it was dark, and I was afraid that there was a big crowd, just dancing in the middle of the room, and I was afraid to go near them because I didn't want to get punched in the face, because this is basically how they're dancing. I was like, we gotta get the fuck out of here. And so we ran, and I yelled at Edgar later, but yeah. So that's basically all the interesting stories I can remember. I'm sure there are more, but that's it. I'm sure if I remember more, I'll talk about them later in, like, future vlogs, but whatevs. So now you know, as badass as I am, whenever I come to different situations at anime cons, I kind of lose my shit. But anyway, this has been story time with Aaron.